Welcome to Celebration Community Church on this Transfiguration Sunday. The weather outside is cold, but as we gather, even virtually, we are warmed by the love of this community of faith. Today is a day for celebrating love of all kinds, not just romantic love, but also the love of family and friends. We are celebrating the recent 27th anniversary of Cindy Prestige and Rachel DeJoyes. And today is the 40th anniversary of Michael Tatum and Gary Cunningham. Let us know if you have a special anniversary coming up. On Wednesday, we had planned to observe Ash Wednesday by having a drive-in worship service. Because of the weather projections, it's going to be very, very cold and chance of snow on Wednesday. So we have decided that we will not do the drive-in service. We'll save that for later, but we will have Ash Wednesday service, and you will be receiving more information about that, about the link to get on the worship service as the weekend goes by. Every Wednesday in Lent, we will gather for a Lenten service on Zoom. Please let us know of any needs that you know of related to the pandemic or the cold weather. On this Transfiguration Sunday, we remember the time when Jesus' identity was revealed to some of his disciples. Even today, Jesus is still being revealed to us through the love and grace of God. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Lift up your hearts to the Lord.
Our call to worship. Behind all things, behind the gray surface, there is a glory escaping, born of heaven and belongs to heaven. A light that welcomes a more profound way of seeing things, that transfigures the world, that casts a spell of hope, that sees the glory of the cross and the life within death. It is a glory that meets us here on this mountain where Jesus Christ, covered in the dust of the world, is caught up in the glory of heaven.
Please pray with me. Holy One, we come before you, many of us feeling like we have climbed just a part of the mountain, and there is so much more of a climb to even dream that we might be dazzled by what is divine. Our loads are heavy with worry, with regret, with fatigue, with illness, with despair for all in the world that is hurting in danger and in bondage and more. We trudge ahead following you, stumbling, hoping, praying, breathing hard, hearts pounding. Lead us, Lord, to the top of the mountain where we might be dazzled by your light, lifted by what is divine, filled by the sheer delight of what is luminous and ethereal. We pray this for ourselves, for one another, and for the world in which we live in. Amen.
Please join us in singing The Gift of Love.
Worship and are free.
from 2 Corinthians. For we do not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your slaves, for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our bodies. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be made visible in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you.
Please pray with me. Creator God, Mother and Father of us all, you created the delicate mustard seed and the most brilliant butterfly. You fill the earth with stones and seashells and pine cones by the billions. Your attention to detail astounds us. And yet we know that you care most of all for your children, all your children. You have promised that if we are lost, you will move heaven and earth to find us. Thank you, O God, for loving each of us without measure, for hurting when we hurt. We pray, O God, that each one who hurts this day will know the grace of your healing love. You know the needs of each of us, and this day we especially pray for Bill Jemison, Dale Boyette, Darlene Pettigo, Julie Pope, Daryl Whitten, David Adcock, Doris Casey, Nancy Crosskill, Frankie Dinwiddie, Glenda Gardner, Glenda Kramer, Chief Master Sergeant Hollis Selman, Shannon Mills Selman, J. Lonnie Stafford, Pat Stafford, Joanne Peters, Joni Bolton, Julia Thieves, Julie Minshew, Kathy Myatt, Liz Rodriguez, Marty Faulkner, Tom Hopper, Virgie Allen, Anne Marie Hull and her family in the loss of her brother, her mother, Barbara, Shoshana Cook and her family in the loss of her father, Franklin. We offer prayers, O God, for all the families of those killed in the terrible wreck on Thursday. We pray for those who are injured. God, we pray for a glimpse of your light, even in the night of deepest pain. We pray to sense your touch that calms and reassures. We pray to remember moments of joy and to be filled with your hope. God, help us to offer to each other gifts of grace and love. We pray to be faithful. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up high on a mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except for Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of grace.
I have always been a person who wants to understand things. That means that I have a lot of questions. You tell me about an illness, and my inclination is to say, Well, have you had this a long time? Did you tell the doctor about the pain you had before? Well, what made you think you had a problem? Did the doctor tell you what caused this? How long has this been going on? What is the treatment? Do you feel comfortable with what the doctor is saying? Well, now I don't always voice these questions to the person with the illness, but it's what goes through my mind. Understanding is key to me. Probably because if I can understand, it makes the situation seem less frightening. And if I can understand, it feels as if I have some sense of control. Now that sounds like a pretty ridiculous statement as I read it aloud, because we know that there isn't a lot in this life over which we have any control. There are some things in life we just can't explain, and we don't have to. It's fine to accept some things as mystery. Rather than try to explain it away, sometimes we need to just sit with it and see if there is a word for us in the mystery. The Transfiguration, which takes place on a mountaintop, is one of those moments. When we try to get into explaining what happened, we find that we can't adequately explain it. Now, there are some things we do know. Days before this moment on the mountain, Jesus asked his disciples an important question. Who are people saying that I am? Now you remember they gave him a variety of answers. Well, some say you're John the Baptist, and some say you're Elijah. And then Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" They stood around with their heads down, and then Peter, we can always count on Peter, says, "You are the Messiah." Now, these are the right words, but we aren't sure that Peter yet understands what it means. This question Jesus asked his disciples is really the main question in the book of Mark, the question of identity. Who is this man called Jesus? Who does he say he is? And who are we in relationship to him? Immediately before this hike up the mountain, Jesus had been talking to the disciples about what they can expect in the days ahead. Jesus begins to teach the disciples that the Son of Man will experience great suffering, be rejected and killed, and then rise again. But they don't really get it. They're confused. It's probably just too much for them. They may be thinking, well, we're just beginning to get into this mission, teaching and healing. Surely Jesus won't leave us. It would be the end of our mission. It was just too much. They weren't quite ready to hear about the cost of discipleship. Emotions are rampant among the disciples, so maybe Jesus asked Peter, James, and John if they'd like to walk up the mountain with him. Many scholars think it was Mount Hermon, although Mount Tabor is another possibility. But where isn't that important? What and who are the reasons Mark tells us this story? When they get to the top, suddenly Jesus is changed, transformed right there in front of them. It's really an unveiling of who Jesus is. His clothes become dazzling white. Jesus is glowing. It is something like the disciples have never seen before in their lives. And then, as if that is not enough, two of the heroes of the faith, Moses and Elijah, show up. They seem to be paying their respect to Jesus. The disciples are terrified. They don't know what to do. Of course, Peter has a problem with just being there with Jesus. He wants to do something. But isn't that a bit like us? Something happens, we don't understand, and we have a need to do something. Like I said earlier, I began trying to understand. Peter suggests they build three buildings. He says, so we could come here every year, or we could come and stay here and remember what has happened on the mountain today. But what happened on the mountain defies description. It is called the Transfiguration. And then a cloud comes over them, and they hear a voice. "This is my beloved. Listen to him." And then it's over. There's silence again on the mountaintop. Right after the story of their experience on the mountain, Jesus again tells them what to expect. In chapter 9 of Mark, he says, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." They're confused all over again. Their constant state in these days is confusion, with a few moments thrown in that defy description. Like those moments when they look at Jesus as he is healing or teaching, and they think about how amazing it is that they answered Jesus' call to follow. Or when they watch as Jesus teaches the little children and the disciples can see the love in his eyes. Or the time those people bring that young woman to him. The one who has been caught in a compromising situation. And Jesus reaches out a hand to her. And there are tears in her eyes because no man has ever treated her with such kindness. And the disciples find themselves wiping away their own tears. Now, we have talked about how Mark rushes at breakneck speed through the events of Jesus' life. He is on an immediate journey. He moves immediately. Brian Blount writes that for 8 chapters, Mark hauls us on an express train to Jerusalem, pausing just long enough at each station for us to peek out the window. But then he gets to this story of the hike up the mountain, and he stops the train. The reader is invited to get off, to look around, and to be there with the disciples, trying to see what they saw and hear what they heard. We must take note of this change and what it might mean. It may mean that this story is very important and we need to stay here a while. How will they ever tell anybody about this? Have you ever had a personal experience that's so powerful? Those moments when we know we cannot adequately describe our experience? We can't even really let ourselves experience what's just happened to us. It may be moments of love or the depths of grief. In a pandemic, we have had many moments that are so painful, we have difficulty describing them. I told you earlier about my 45-year-old friend who caught COVID early on and had difficulty convincing anyone that he needed help. When he finally got a hospital to admit him, the doctor came in and said, "Mr. Shepherd, you have the worst lungs I have ever seen. You should call your family and share your goodbyes." Such a young man with 3 little children. It just took my breath away, almost more than I could take in. When I was in Israel and saw the wall that divides the Israeli side from the Palestinian side for the first time, it took my breath away. It was so tall, so cold, it was more than I could take in. Now we have much the same feeling when it is an experience of great beauty and love. Have you ever looked at a painting or heard a piece of music that just takes your breath away? The first time I saw the ballet Carmina Burana, I was awestruck. It was so beautiful, the music and the dancing. Tears came to my eyes. There was no explaining or describing it. Or the first time I looked at our daughter right after she was born. We've all taken such great joy in John and Ralph's new baby girl, Farah. She is so precious, and their love for her is such a beautiful thing. But one feels it cannot be adequately described or explained. We just kind of catch our breath when we experience it. The story is told that when Toscanini, the Italian concertmaster, finished 60 rehearsals of Bellini's Norma, that at the dress rehearsal he put down the baton and he said, "The concert is canceled." "Why?" he said. "The music is too great. It's beyond human powers. I cannot do it." Now, La Jolla is a picturesque beach town just north of San Diego. And when we go there, we always plan to go to the cliffs over the beach one evening to watch the sunset. There are seals all around, and we sit on the rocks as we look into the western sky over the ocean. When the time for sunset arrives, it is as if the sun simply drops from the horizon. It is magnificent, and it takes my breath away. The beauty is too much. When Jesus and the disciples start down the mountain, Jesus tells Peter, James, and John, "Don't tell anyone about what has happened until after I have risen from the dead." Can't you imagine that they just kind of breathed a sigh of relief, because how could they describe what they had just seen, what they felt? That day on the mountain was probably just too much for the disciples. They were terrified. They didn't know what to say. And how does one describe such an experience? We often come to church wanting answers, and sometimes we leave with more questions than answers. But that's okay. We have difficulty sitting with mystery. Maybe it frightens us. Maybe we feel helpless because there is nothing to do. But if we are to be transformed, maybe we must open ourselves to the transforming, redeeming work of God's grace. Maybe what is asked of us is that we just sit with these experiences for a while. Maybe God asks that we be present in the moment to take it all in, to ponder, to listen for God's word to us and for our lives, rather than rushing into action and taking control, trying to understand. Maybe we just need to hear the story and let it be mystery that we don't have to understand or explain. Both moments of pain and moments of love and beauty must be fully tasted if they are to be transformative. They must be experienced fully. Now, in these days of pandemic, all many of us can think about is, how soon will this be over? That is a normal reaction, but there are lessons that we can learn in a pandemic. A pandemic can teach us to wait on the Lord, to give thanks in all things, not for all things, but in all things. Learning to find the moments of beauty and love in a difficult time. Moments of love and beauty must be savored as well, and we are often like visitors to an art museum, rushing from one painting to the other, lest we miss any one work of art. Perhaps it's more important to stand with one piece for a time, with love to taste each moment, to focus and to take an interior snapshot so we can take it out and savor it again and again. Now, Peter didn't do anything wrong. He just seemed to have trouble focusing his mind on the present. He seemed to be so afraid of what might come up that he got afraid of his own emotions. He feared his own fear, and that got in the way of God's transforming moment. It is by God's grace that we are transformed little by little. Anne Lamott writes, "I do not at all understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are, but does not leave us where it found us." Fred Craddock tells about his first year in college. He says it was a little college in eastern Tennessee, In the first semester of his freshman year, a classmate named Bill Loft sat in a chair in the back of the room, and he asked Professor Lambert a question, a profound question, apparently. Fred said he didn't quite get the question, but it must have been extraordinary. He said Professor Lambert paused, and Fred thought, well, he doesn't even know the answer. And then the professor's eyes welled up with tears, and Fred thought, there's something else here. And then the professor said, Mr. Loft, I think it would be better for all of us if I delayed my answer. Well, Fred said he didn't think about it much anymore, but when they were in their last semester of their senior year in an advanced class, they were trying to read the Greek, and Professor Lambert stopped, and he said, Mr. Loft, about your question. Craddock says that some things just take time. We piece together a little bit of faith to live by. It's made up of snippets of things in our lives. The question of a child, a burst of laughter, a walk to the mailbox, struggling with the text, a little prayer in the morning, or conversation with a friend, an evening meal. We just piece it together. The disciples had to sit with transfiguration for a while. And maybe we try to tell the stories too soon. But they knew they couldn't walk down the mountain and say, guess what? On Wednesday, we will begin Lent with the observance of Ash Wednesday. We will begin our journey toward the cross, the tomb, and what comes after the tomb. Jesus was transformed on the mountaintop, and we are called to open our eyes and ears to the glimpses of transformation that are revealed to us each day. May God help us with our fears so we can open ourselves to grace, grace which transforms us and makes us whole. And maybe then we can tell the story of what we have seen and heard. Amen.
Oh, what I would do to have the kind of faith it takes to climb out of this boat I'm in, onto the crashing waves, step out of my comfort zone into the realm of the unknown where Jesus is and he's holding out his hand. But the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I've tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win, you'll never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I will choose to listen and believe the voice of truth. And oh, what I would do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant with just a sling and a stone, surrounded by the sound of a thousand warriors shaking in their armor, wishing they'd have had the strength to stand. But the giant's calling out my name and he laughs at me, reminding me of all the times I've tried before and failed. The giant keeps on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win. You'll never win, no. But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says, do not be afraid. And the voice of truth says, this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I will choose to listen and believe the voice of truth. But the stone was just the right size to put the giant on the ground. And the waves, they don't seem so high from the top of them looking down. I will soar with the wings of eagles when I stop and listen to the sound of Jesus singing over me. Voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says, do not be afraid. The voice of truth says, this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me, I will choose to listen and believe. I will choose to listen and believe the voice of truth. I will listen and believe. I will listen and believe the voice of truth. I will listen to the voice of truth.
And now, it is the time for us to bring our offerings to God, our offerings of ourself and our resources to be used by God in the work of this church. Thank you always for your faithfulness in giving. And now we gather at this table, this meal, when we share the bread and the cup at this table, we acknowledge that sin is strong, but grace is so much stronger. Through this meal, we open ourselves to God's transforming work of grace. So come now. Come and eat. There is room at this table for everyone. On that night, Jesus sat with his disciples. He knew that their time was short. And he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, this is my body broken for you. Every time you eat it, remember, it is the bread of life, the body of Christ. And then he took the cup in the same way and he blessed it and he gave it to them saying, this is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me. Remember my love, my grace. It is the blood of Christ, the cup of grace. Please pray with me. Mighty God, we give you thanks this day for the blessings of this table, for this bread and this cup that nourish our lives for good. Thank you for meeting us here every Sunday. We give you thanks, O God. Amen.
Rise no more, but the Master of the sea heard my
And now, as we leave this time of worship, remember that the holy mystery that we call God is a refuge for all who are oppressed, a refuge for us in times of trouble. Go from this place feeling embraced by the source of life and love and hope, following in the way of Jesus, who is just and compassionate. May you be encouraged by the Spirit of grace, which sustains us. Amen.